FDR's fireside chats forever changed the way our presidents communicate. In fact, as Ted Koppel now tells us, they set an example for every president to come.
Imagine the world a century ago. There was film, of course, but the news was delivered almost exclusively in print. Tens of millions had been killed in the First World War. Tens of millions more died in a global influenza pandemic. After the war, in France, the American president, Woodrow Wilson, mustered his wartime allies behind a so-called League of Nations. But he couldn't sell the plan here at home. Wilson crisscrossed the country by rail, delivering one speech after another. The effort almost killed him.
It's easy to think, okay, presidents are always kind of barnstorming, going around the country, talking to the people.
Jill Lepore is professor of American history at Harvard University.
To campaign on your own behalf was considered undignified well through the 19th century. So even just going around the country was a novelty.
In effect, Wilson was going door to door, but he had none of the tools that would amplify the campaigns of future presidents. Not that Warren Harding recognized radio's potential. As for Calvin Coolidge, they didn't call him Silent Cal for nothing. Herbert Hoover? No, he never got the hang of radio either. That was left for Franklin Roosevelt and those famous fireside chats.
This bank holiday, while resulting in many cases in great inconvenience, is affording us the opportunity to supply the currency necessary to meet the situation.
And he's explaining to the American people he's about to shut down the banking system. And there's an incredible intimacy to his voice, but it has a quality of compassion to it.
It is your problem, my friends. Your problem no less than it is mine. Together, we cannot fail.
This, remember, was at a time when radio announcers wore tuxedos to work.
Quiet, please.
When their delivery was incredibly stylized.
Rubinoff and his violin.
And what did FDR do?
The task that we Americans now face.
He memorized those talks so that his delivery was much more relaxed.
Never before have we had so little time in which to do so much.
He understood that radio was a performative medium, that it wasn't like other kinds of performances. FDR, I think, kind of took that philosophy to the citizenry itself, right? That he would try to enlist their support by what would appear to be a kind of casual conversation, as opposed to delivering, you know, the State of the Union address.
You like Ike, I like Ike, everybody likes Ike.
By the time Dwight Eisenhower decided to run for president in 1952, his Republican backers convinced Ike to try his hand at this new medium of television.
Eisenhower Answers America.
He agreed to participate in this campaign called Eisenhower Answers America. And they're completely staged. But he went into a studio and off of cue cards, he read these answers to Americans' questions.
What party put prices up?
And then days later, the advertising agency picked up people who were waiting in line for tickets at Radio City Music Hall, brought them in and had them read from cue cards the questions. And then the questions and the answers are cut together.
General, the Democrats are telling me I never had it so good.
Can that be true when America is billions in debt? When prices have doubled, when taxes break our backs?
And Eisenhower says, no, and it's time for a change.
And it's time for a change.
Crude, but effective. He won.
I, Dwight D. Eisenhower, do solemnly swear.
And would become the first president to hold a televised press conference.
Well, I see we're trying a new experiment this morning. I hope it doesn't prove to be a disturbing influence. I have no announcements. We'll go directly to questions.
Good evening.
The first televised presidential debate, meanwhile, showed Richard Nixon slightly ill at ease with a glistening upper lip. Television viewers and ultimately the voters watched and picked John F. Kennedy. He was the first president to master that medium.
Could you tell us generally your feelings about your press conferences today and your feelings about how they're conducted?
Well, you're subject me to some abuse, but not to any lack of respect, I don't think.
You wanted law and order in this town.
Ronald Reagan, with years of Hollywood experience under his belt, was, if anything, an even more polished performer.
I will not make age an issue of this campaign. I am not going to exploit, for political purposes, my opponent's youth and inexperience.
And the other presidents simply provided variations on a theme. The Carter grin that reminded folks of his humble origins as a peanut farmer. Bill Clinton's tentative nibble of the lower lip, that slightly querulous voice.
These allegations are false.
These were simply adaptive techniques to a familiar medium. It wasn't until Donald Trump that we witnessed the end of an era, when television anchors and correspondents who once served as gatekeepers between politicians and their public were simply brushed aside. He and I spoke on the day he was nominated.
Between Facebook and Twitter, I have over 20 million people, and that's a big audience. And it's also you and the media and everybody's watching.
It allows you to circumvent.
It allows me to get across a point very quickly in seconds. I mean, there was never anything like that. And that gives me a big, big base in terms of a campaign. In terms of a presidency, I don't think I'd use it very much at all.
Clearly, he changed his mind. Never have presidential thumbs communicated so much to so many with such direct impact. Trump doesn't need the intervention of the media giants. The tweets generate so much interest and attention.
President Trump retweeting last night an attack on Dr. Anthony Fauci.
That the networks and cable channels and newspapers are all but powerless to dismiss them or him. And the dirty little secret is that while Donald J. Trump has done everything he can to wreck the profession of journalism,
they are truly an enemy of the people. The fake news, enemy of the people. They really are. They are so bad.
He's been very, very good for the business. More than any predecessor, President Trump sets the agenda for what we read, what we hear.
Recipe. Trump doesn't bash anybody until they hit him. And if they or anyone hits him, then look out.
And what we watch.
He posted 30 times on Twitter on Sunday alone.
You may love him or loathe him, but just try to ignore him.